Good evening, everyone. I'm Clayton Cheever. I am the Assistant Director at the Thomas Crane Public Library in Quincy, Massachusetts. It is my pleasure to welcome you this evening for our program that we are co-sponsoring with the Quincy Climate Action Network. We've done many such programs with QCAN before. Hopefully, I'm getting some weird feedback on mine, so hopefully my video on all your screens isn't poor. We did some testing ahead of time, and Zig was very clear, so you don't have to put up with me for very long. So if you're having a suboptimal experience, please hang with us, and as soon as I pass the spotlight on to David and to Zig, I promise everything will be good, and I'll be in the background providing tech support. I'm going to stop talking, and I'm going to pass the baton to David Reich with the Quincy Climate Action Network, who will say a few words further before we get started with Zig. David, take it away.
Wonderful. Thank you, Clayton. Thanks to the Thomas Crane Library for partnering with QCAN. As you said, it's been about 8 years, and we've co-sponsored probably a couple of dozen events together, lectures by experts from places like the Sierra Club and the Union of Concerned Scientists, and from Harvard and BU. And films about climate change and how to respond to climate change. QCAN's not just an educational group, though. We also do advocacy, and I could cite a long list of the positive changes we've helped bring to Quincy, but I think we're largely among friends here. For anyone who'd like more detail about that, have a look at our website, www.quincycan.org. The About QCAN tab on our homepage will take you to a sampling of some of the stuff we've accomplished. For now, I'll just say that we've helped make the city more energy efficient and help bring in a lot of clean renewable energy process that's ongoing as the city works to form a green electricity aggregation. Other stuff we're working on currently, we're pushing on the cities to start using electric fleet vehicles, and there may be some good news on that forthcoming in the next while. We're trying to make sure that new buildings constructed in Quincy, and especially buildings constructed by the city, adhere to the most rigorous efficiency standards. And we're working to get the MBTA to replace the old-style diesel buses that are befouling our air here in the city with zero-emission electric buses. A fight that I think will be going on for a year or two, but we've launched into it already with help from the Green Energy Consumers Alliance. If you'd like to be part of this exciting movement, we welcome new members. Meetings are open to everyone. We've been meeting online via Zoom, and you can we meet on the second Wednesday of the month, 7 p.m. And if you'd like to attend that meeting or any future meeting, you can send an email to info@quincycan.org, and we'll send you a link that will allow you to get into the meeting. So enough of that. Now to the business at hand. Our lecturer this evening, Professor Sigmund Platter of Boston College Law School, is a genuine hero of the environmental movement. Among his claims to fame, he served as chief plaintiff's counsel in the landmark endangered species case, Tennessee Valley Authority versus Hill. Not only did Zig help save a species that was slated for certain extinction, but a Supreme Court decision in the case established that the Endangered Species Act means exactly what it says, that it allows no exceptions. His book about that case, The Snail Daughter and the Dam, was published by Yale University Press. Sig has also had a hand in many other famous cases. He consulted for the plaintiffs in the Woburn toxic waste litigation, that became the subject of the book and movie, A Civil Action. I consulted for the plaintiffs in the Deepwater Horizon oil spill, which he mentioned a few minutes ago as we were chatting. And as you're going to find out soon, he chaired the Alaska State Commission that investigated the Exxon Valdez disaster and learned some useful truths about our politics that also apply to today's fight against climate change. As if all those accomplishments were not enough, Zig is also lead author of Environmental Law and Policy, a textbook now in its fifth edition, and he's published in 40 plus law reviews. He has a BA from Princeton, a JD from Yale. He's won numerous awards, and as you're going to find out, he's a hell of an entertaining speaker. Zig?
I hope I can live up to that. Greetings, everyone. So I was having a conversation with David about the calamities that all of us are living with. I mean, every day we're thinking of COVID-19 and behind it, climate. And these both, Clay. And so we were talking about these calamities, COVID-19 and climate, and how the whole world is trying to figure out how to handle puzzles that had never before been so big. And I said something about how, well, you got to learn from disasters. You can't learn from professors. And David said, well, what do you mean? And I was the chair of the legal task force for the State of Alaska Oil Spill Commission. And disasters in the past sometimes are easier to look at. We've had more time to digest them, and they're a little bit less controversial. And so David said, well, why don't you bring that to Quincy, which is a town that has a city that has a bunch of people who are interested and care and are smart. And so, you know, most journalists that I've worked with are not half as smart as David. And so I took him seriously. I said, okay, let's do it. And so that is what we're going to do this evening. Clayton, shall we just start, or what should we do?
I think we're good to jump right in. I'm just letting everybody know that if they have any questions, they can ask it in the chat streams, and I'll just plot that in there. And if you have any links or anything that you'd like people to follow, I did put a link for Quincy Can into the chat stream on all three channels. So if there's anything else you'd like me to share, Zig, please let me know.
Now, can you see that first slide?
We can. You're looking good.
Marvelous. Okay. So I felt favored to be able to be pulled into the Exxon Valdez case, but it was miserable as well. And so it turns out that my students were an amazing help to the commission. Here are some of them. I went and said to my students, the commission doesn't have a lot of money. We need free labor. I need at least 5 people, no credit, no money. And I got 17 people who prepared a bunch of reports. And my chair for the commission said, what are you feeding those kids in Boston? We got more input for the Exxon Valdez oil spill from Boston College than we got from any non-governmental organization in the U.S. Anyway, so do you see where we are? Oh, by the way, oops, no. I'm trying. Can you see this arrow, Clayton? I'm using a
yes, we can see your arrow. Yep, we can see your error. Yep,
all right,
you're good.
So this is the Alaska oil system. It's a mega system, probably in terms of direct mileage, one of the greatest. This is the North Slope, Prudhoe Bay, on the Arctic oceans. And this is the pipeline, which has been built. You're looking at 800 miles over 2 mountain ranges, and by the way, a bunch of earthquake seismic zones, coming down over the last range of mountains to the town of Valdez. And that's where there is a tank farm to the oil is stored for a day or two or more, and then loaded into ships that go, as you can imagine, a long way down the coast, sometimes to Cherry Point in Washington, but almost all of them to Long Beach, which is one of the reasons why Long Beach, with the refineries, has some of the worst hotspots for air pollution in the United States. So the fact is, you've got these. Oh, damn it. I didn't mean to give away the, but you know, the next slide has the splat. Well, let's go right there. This is the Exxon Valdez oil spill schematically. The Gulf, Prince William Sound and the Gulf of Alaska got hit terribly by a malfunction in the system you're looking at. And this particular problem was a single hulled tanker that hit a rock. But let's, I'm just thinking now how, oh damn. Okay, so here's how it looks. Do you see the red line? That's the pipeline coming down over the last range of mountains. And do you see on the shore there, that's the loading area, and I have a schematic boat there. It's like a fjord. It's very deep, and so the ship can be very close to shore, and it loads up with oil. Now, I've got to tell you, the problems of this disaster are many, and I'm going to give you a whole bunch of them. It turns out, all right, we've got a single-hulled tanker longer than 3 football fields. It's divided into 11 different compartments from the front to the back. And it turns out that it was being loaded by its crew at that time. Why do you have to have careful loading? Well, previously, there had been professional 24/7 crews, because if you fill a single hull tanker too much in just the middle, it sinks and the boat cracks. Or if you fill the bow and the stern, they sink and the middle comes up. So it requires extraordinary expertise. But Alyeska, which was not a corporation, the partnership of 7 different oil companies, including Exxon and BP, dominated by BP, 51%, said, we can save $4 million a year by laying off the expert loaders and having the ship's seapersons themselves load their ship. And they'll be careful because they don't want to die. And so that's what they were doing. But here's the other thing. To save money, Exxon and every other company had been cutting back, not just on the loading crews, but on the crews for the ships. All right, the Exxon Valdez that we'll see in a bit was designed, do you know, how many seamen? 36. And some accountant decided, well, if we lay one person off, we save $2.5 million a year for shore support and all kinds of things. So they laid a person off. And then the next one, after the first one got promoted, also said, let's lay him. The Exxon Valdez was sailing with only 16 people. And they were supposed to be asleep, getting ready for the trip back to LA, but they had to load the ship. In any event, that ship got loaded, and around a little after 9 o'clock in the evening of March 23rd, it started moving down through the Valdez Cut. The pilot got off right where the ship is there, and proceeded further. But as you can see, that's the Columbia Glacier up on the upper left. It's been calving, and there were glacier blocks out in the middle of the channel. So the captain said, let's shift a little bit to the right. And so they did. And the ship proceeded in that way. The trouble was, there was only one person on the deck at that time, because the captain had to go down to his cabin. Why? To do the financial records of the turnaround. Why? Because the bursar had been fired to save money. Are you getting an idea here? Okay, and so out they go, and the radar doesn't tell them that they're a little bit too far to the right. the guy who is steering hasn't slept for 18 hours and he has the ship on autopilot. His relief comes up and she looks out and she says, oh my God, this is Bly Reef. Look at the light. It's supposed to be way over to our left, our port, and it's over to our right. So they tried to turn. They tried to spin it. And they called the captain who was coming up the stairs when this happened. It hit. I've flown over and looked down. There are spines of granite coming up from very deep, and they just ripped a single hull. The single hull was not a double because the head of Exxon Shipping had been the Coast Guard commandant, and he convinced Jimmy Carter that you didn't need double hulls. The radar, which should have warned them about the fact that they were off, had been cut back to a cheaper system because the industry didn't want to pay for it, and the Coast Guard went along. And the ship is there, rocking and ripping, and the captain looks over and picks up the mic and says, Valdez, we've run aground a little, and we're losing a little oil. And that turned out, by the way, to be the public disclosure that prevented criminal liability for the corporation. But the problem was, it couldn't get off. Actually, they tried to get it off, which would have made it worse. But the first of 13 million gallons of oil started falling out. Right, you can see Bly Reef here. And this is Hinchinbrook Island. It would have had rapid response, except Alyeska persuaded the federal government that they didn't need a rapid response because they could always get stuff from here, from Valdez, and get it out fast. Oops, hold on. So I want you to see also this. So you're getting an idea of why this happened. This is the channel, the official channel, but the corporation persuaded the Coast Guard to make it voluntary, not mandatory. And so, as you can imagine, ships sometimes followed the channel and sometimes didn't. It was an accident waiting to happen. Here is Cordova, and the fishermen there had been warning the local government and the state government of Valdez is up here, that this was an accident waiting to happen. The pipeline leaked. The tanks were substandard. There was no pollution control. They worried about the loading crew. They worried about the fact that the crews were sailing with half of what they were designed for and were sound asleep at the wheel sometimes. The fishermen knew this. In fact, that evening, one of the fishermen, Ricky Ott from Cordova, was talking to the Valdez Chamber of Commerce and said, look, gentlemen, we fishermen know the question isn't if a big one comes, it's only when. And it was 2 hours after she said that, that the Exxon Valdez hit Bly Reef. In any event, the disaster didn't have to be terrible. For the first 40 hours, there was no wind, which is very rare. And it turned out that nothing was done to boom it. And the fishermen finally went to the Valdez headquarters and Coast Guard and Exxon and said, why aren't you booming it? And they said, well, the booms are covered with ice here in Valdez, and the Betty B, the boat that's supposed to lay the boom, is down in Seattle getting fixed. I don't know if I'm giving you too much detail, but you're getting the idea. They had one boat. The fishermen said, look at that mountain up there. The wind is starting to blow. It's too late to catch it all. We will lay the boom for you. And so the fishermen were the ones who got the boom and started laying, but far from here because the oil already was off and running. As you can see, with the wind blowing from the northeast, it went down more than 1,000 miles of sea coast. And wherever it touched, it killed. And it could have been stopped right at the ship if indeed the response system had been ready and the expertise was there. By the way, the government people and the Exxon people didn't know where to boom. So the fishermen who had been excluded initially from the headquarters went to the map and told the governments, state and federal, where they could have saving for some of the seal pup, for some of the best fish spawning and so forth. Anyway, this is the god-awfulness. And something like 5% of the wildlife maybe was saved, but the vast majority died. And here I am, do you see, I'm picking up rocks. They'd sprayed this beach, the beaches in Alaska are rocks, so that the vice president could walk and say that it was clean. And then he went away. If you lift up the rock and put on your hands, the oil was right underneath. Over on the right, you can see that these guys spraying this stuff. Do you see a ventilator? No, you don't. One of the guys came to me and said, look, this stuff that we're spraying, this dispersant, we are all peeing blood. So you can see, not only are they only cleaning the top, but they're doing it in a way that lets the television camera get a clean bunch of rocks. But it's poison. It's poison. And by the way, they said, but we don't tell the foreman because they'll send us back to Texas. They were making 30 bucks an hour, and they didn't want to lose that. In any event, the problem, as you can see, became humongous. And in this is sort of an ecological image. The oil hits a delicate ecosystem and kills everywhere it touches. So as you know, the national media followed it closely, and very quickly, everyone decided what caused this. It was a drunk captain. He had had 3 drinks in the afternoon before he went there at 9 o'clock to sail out. And we were told on the commission that drunk, he was a better captain than anybody else in the trade, although he was down in the cabin doing the financial records, right? And it turns out that as the commission went through, by the way, this map was the way the commission was leveraged, not just to talk about ships for sailing from Alaska down to LA, but we found out that there was leakage both of gas and of oil in the tundra up there. The commission got lots of evidence about blowouts in the tundra. Oh, damn it. Sorry, guys. Where the pipeline is crossing, some whistleblowers tipped us off. Down in Valdez, this is the loading area and also the tank farm. And the offshore oil drilling in some places too was leaking. This map was done by my students. They copied it from an Encyclopedia Britannica and then put their little charts on. But to say, it's not just the ships. It's a mega system. And the commission picked up on this and said, it's a mega system. And the bigger it is, it seems, the less the government is able to regulate it. This crash was the result of collusion, complacency, and neglect. And it turns out that the students helped immensely writing the commission's report, and there were 59 recommendations. This shouldn't ever happen again. 9 or 10 of those were specific to Alaska, and all the rest would prevent the kind of disaster happening again. And so the report talks before the fact, the government, all the officials, corporate government and public government has got to be aware, has to do prevention planning, take actions, preparing for response. And now you already know so much more than the American public about how there was very poor planning. The prevention actions and the response were not ready for the worst case. They weren't even ready for a smaller case. But also, the governance system has got to be planning for after the fact of a disaster, after you learn that COVID-19 is coming, after you learn the facts on global greenhouse gas climate change. And after the fact, you have to jump into action with rapid accessing of information. Do you see why this is relevant 30 years later? Rapid, appropriate response actions, and then monitoring and adaptations as necessary, systemic changes. The chair of my commission said, do you know what John Kennedy said government has to be like? It has to be like basketball, not like football. Because in football, they just line up, they know what they're going to do, bang. In basketball, you have to keep watching and adjust to what's going on and have an agenda that is flexible. And he said, we need government like that as well. Unfortunately, this chart is great in seminar, where you see, you conceptualize the problem, you plan actions before, and you monitor when it is coming upon you. Then you implement the monitoring, you adapt, you analyze, you change your system. We're in the middle of systemic changes, praise God. And then you share that learning feedback loop back into the governance planning, right? This is adaptive resiliency. And this is what our commission said has to be part of the governance. But do you see, 20 years later, the spill report for the Exxon Valdez had not been acted upon. And 20 years before Exxon Valdez, the Santa Barbara spill had given us lessons that weren't acted upon. And here we are in the middle of another calamity. These are my students. I said I need 10 and I got 37. And those white papers were sent to the President's Commission on the Deepwater Horizon. the executive director called me immediately and said, these students have opened doors that politically we were not able to address, including the fact that dispersants should not be used, that should be skimmers. But the industry said, by saving money, we just spray, and that's all you need. Why does this happen? Well, why do these things happen when they're foreseeable? And once they happen, why is the government often so inept? When I went to Washington, I was working a little bit on Alaska lands, but mostly on endangered species. They said to me, look, all of government is an iron triangle. I'd never heard of that. What do you mean? A triangle is a rigid, very strong geometric figure. And you have the industry, you have the agency that's supposed to regulate the industry, but it also often subsidizes the industry. And you have the congressional clique that's part of the triangle because of campaign finance from the industry. And it turns out, they said, there's not just waterway or shipping. There, and this is only like a tenth of the triangles that dominate the Washington I had to work in. Timber, railroads, mining, oil and gas. Of course, fossil fuels is probably the biggest now that the NRA is under siege. Highways, pesticides, big pharma, big banking, home builders. I mean, you think about it. These day by day are involved with everything going on, whereas the media can only cover 4, 5, 6 issues. And this is at the state level as well. So this is the same triangle in the Gulf. The Mineral Mining Service was literally not just complacency, collusion, and neglect, but drugs and sex with the industry. I can tell you more offline. And up in Washington, Dick Cheney was almost president of the United States and dominated the planning for fossil fuel. It is a system that's rigid and non-adaptive and not ready. And by the way, just to give you a sense of the Iron Triangle, when I did my endangered species work, funded by t-shirts and my Visa card, these were the people lined up against the Endangered Species Act because it allowed citizens to raise substantial questions about projects and programs. Look, do you see the power? The wonder is that environmentalists ever win anything, and it's only when the facts are overwhelming. All right, here's something else I want to share with you. Subsidiarity. It's not talked about much in the United States, but when I taught in Africa, they talked about subsidiarity. It's a canon law. What does it mean? Decisions should be made at the lowest level at which they can be rationally and competently made. And sometimes that's the United Nations. But often it's down on the ground. The local government, or remember, the fishermen were the ones who knew this was coming, knew what had to be done. Subsidiarity is a very interesting doctrine. And it's the kind of thing I tell my students is really quite important if you want to understand how governance should work. Because in any project or program, there are several different layers which should be consulted for different things. So now, if you look, there the layers of government, by the lower left, the IMO, the International Maritime Association organization, is completely dominated by the industry. The International Arctic Council actually is stronger. My chairman of the Oil Spill Committee is on the Arctic Council. The Alaska state government, 90% of its revenues at this time were coming from oil. There are tribes, the municipalities. Valdez was desperately worried, but was not listened to. And the fishermen, as you saw, they were the ones who knew what was coming. And when it came, they were the ones who knew what to do. And the federal government was dominated again by a Coast Guard that had said, oh no, we just need single hulls. So the politics of it is different from the rationality of it. Subsidiarity, I mean, for instance, in air pollution and water pollution, the federal government has to set a national standard, but it's far better for the states and municipalities to be the ones that actually broker that standard into reality. Well, it turns out the answer to bad subsidiarity is people. And so as part of what we did, this is quite unusual. If any of you has a student wanting to look for a term paper, the Regional Citizens Advisory Council was set up in the settlement we reached with Exxon, and it subsequently went in to the Oil Pollution Act of 1990, that citizens will sit with the power of oversight officially within the governance, with the ability to go to the federal government, to the state government, to the local government, and say, this is the truth, and you're ignoring it. It's a kind of pluralism that is quite unprecedented. Look what it does. This is kind of political science. For years and years and years, it was a dipolar system of government. The market was what guaranteed, you know, we would have wealth and quality of life and food and homelessness. But the fact, though, that the private marketplace had external costs that were like pollution, like child labor, that government has to come in and resolve, the legislature and agencies. It's dipolar. The trouble is power attracts. And very often, if you are working in Congress or in an agency and you have a problem coming from the fossil fuel industry, do you see, it's best to be reasonable, because as soon as you've got your 20 years, you're going to want to retire into a more powerful job with more money, and it's in the industry you know best. Agency capture is part of the problem. And part of the answer is this. Starting in 1960, environmentalists, well, actually first, Martin Luther King, then Ralph Nader, and then environmentalists came in. 20 of the bills that were passed into law by the greatest environmental president in our history Who was that? Richard Nixon was told that environment was the big thing. And so he said, I'm going to be the environment. Anyway, each of those statutes, we put in a provision saying citizens can enforce the law if the government doesn't. The Iron Triangle can be directly sued from outside the triangle. You don't have to wait for a government agency. So what you're looking at is still a battle, because every one of the Bush and Trump appointments to the Supreme Court is against citizen suits, against pluralism. The dipolar system favors the establishment of the past. I would say that pluralism, multicentric, is what you need to adjust for the future. So you see, there's some political science philosophy for you. Let's stop there for a moment. Clayton, look at the chats. Are there questions that we should address right now?
We've had a couple of technical questions about making sure people's audio and such was working. Okay. Asking if there were going to be multiple part, and I've assured folks, nope, this is a one-time presentation. Well, so that's where we are right now.
How wonderful my presentation has been so far. Talking about causation from a rigid triangle, the subsidiarity and the idea of pluralism like basketball JFK. And there's one other thing that comes from this. And this is a principle that was produced by Marcel Puyer, a professor in Limoges in France. And he said, look, it is so hard to get public value regulations, public protections into a government system, that we have to have a jurisprudential principle that just in general, public protections will not be reversed by political pressure coming from the interests who are regulated. And this has been adopted. The Supreme Court of Brazil has adopted it. It's in a number of international conventions. But as you can imagine, non-regression is something that the Iron Triangles desperately resist. Bill Douglas was in my class once in Tennessee, and he said, as I told my old friend, Franklin Roosevelt, your agency should be shut down after 5 or 10 years because they're no good. They're going to be totally in bed by that time. All right. Clayton, are we ready to go to climate?
Let's go to climate.
David, do you have any questions so far? Oops, is David muted?
Yeah, I'm good. I'm good. I do want to hear what you have to say about climate and the Iron Triangles, and may have some questions after that.
Yeah.
And I do think it's fair to say that, just to give people a preview, we're going to talk about climate, and then we're going to end with, I don't know if it's an end, but we're also going to talk about the pandemic that we're currently experiencing and some lessons to apply to that. So a little teaser for things to come for folks.
Okay, you're looking at the climate curve. It turns out that LBJ was told, actually in 1964, by the Rand Corporation, there is something that is going to change the world to the negative unless we do something now. That greenhouse gases are starting to change the temperature, and that could melt the ice within the next 100 years. grossly overestimating the number of years. And look, LBJ thought that his environmental laws would make a difference and did nothing. Nixon had signed 22 environmental laws and he did nothing because he was told quite quickly that his base was based in the marketplace, and the marketplace was built on ignoring climate. Ford at first started listening to the scientists and then was told by the political people that he wouldn't get reelected, and that happened. And Carter came in, an engineer, and he was freaked out by this, but he also was told that he had no political power against this, because the political iron triangles were against virtually every economic and scientific agenda that he tried to bring in to government. Reagan, as you can imagine, reversed a number of the things that Carter put in and was basically a market-driven, triangle-driven presidency. He's a sweet guy. Bush, Papa Bush, 4 years, he was in the CIA. The CIA had been worried about climate change. Bush knew all about it, but he also knew that the fossil fuel industry was the only way he could get a second term against the Democrats. He didn't. Clinton came in, but Clinton turned out to be kind of a Republican Democrat and did nothing for climate change. And look, it's growing. Bush too, at first Mr. Bush was talking about greenhouse gases. And then Cheney took over, if you've seen the movie W, and basically it was a Cheney administration. And the policy was set that fossil fuels were not to be regulated. Fracking could not be regulated at all under any statute. Obama came in and had a marvelous agenda in many ways, but in climate. And then it turned out that it was blocked for 2 years by the Iron Triangle, and then the Senate went went Republican, and Obama collapsed. He said, all right, we're going to try to get all of the above. And Trump, of course, is the one who said, you shall not talk about climate change. And we are now, has everybody had a nice summer or a hot, humid summer? I mean, you're looking at it. This is a tragedy. And it's a tragedy for my grandchildren or great-grandchildren, because to reverse this takes at least two generations if we start reversing it. And you know, it's a disaster. I think, by the way, this book over here, Losing Earth, A Recent History by Nathaniel Rich, is really quite amazing. And it turns out that in 2016, Obama and the US government was critically important in getting the Paris Agreement to be ratified by most countries, not by ours, but Obama signed it in a way I can talk about at some point. And Obama started moving. The Clean Power Plan that he had was an extraordinary way. Do you see how the way he was trying to slow down on coal, unless it was clean coal, and shift to renewables would increase employment in the US and decrease greenhouse gases? Not as much as the scientists want, but this plan, the Clean Power Plan, was really quite extraordinary. We were hopeful. And coal, the market started listening to Obama and saying, well, we don't need to go into coal so much, although China kept going. But then, as you can see, the Trump administration, each of these is an initiative. You can see the Clean Power Plan, but all of these have been attacked, targeted, and some of them have been nullified, some of them have been repealed. We are in regression. And the climate is not subject to electoral change. The climate is going to be there, and it has to be handled by people outside government as well as people inside government, because this is the way the current administration, these are the regulations that were targeted for destruction in the first year. And that was an amazing accomplishment in the first year. If you look here, this is just the first year. Environment wins. 58 environmental protections were reversed, diluted, or at least attacked Labor and finance, look, we're twice as good as everybody else in terms of deregulation. The number today is 95, and overall, close to 300, health, safety, civil rights, financial protection, immigration, obviously, regression. We have a lot of work to do. And you can see that Michel Prieur is feeling terrible about the whole thing. Just in terms of oil, there were some rules that were put into the Gulf of Mexico by Obama after our reports on the Deepwater Horizon. The Trump eliminated half of the blowout preventers, cut back on inspections. They could be done by the companies themselves. No third-party inspections, and real-time monitoring stopped. Everything was going to be done by telephone. Anyway, okay, where are we now? This is a different crisis, and I want you to note that some of the same problems, iron triangles and so forth, are clearly problematic. But government action is far more visible here. Why is that? Because analytically, which is the greater danger to us? Climate or COVID-19? Is COVID-19 going to be there for my great-grandchildren? I like this image. Do you see anything distinguishing between the countries most affected by the virus and the countries that have managed it best? I don't know what the difference might be, but they're nice pictures. You see my point. It turns out that when women have come into government, they are more observant, more adaptive, they have to be to live with us, more resilient, and ultimately much more like basketball than us football guys. This is the tragedy that we are in, and it is a tragedy that the rest of the world, no one else has managed it as bad. Even Brazil has managed it better than we have with the denialist president. I mean, I don't feel ashamed with my students for being non-neutral on this. Look at Dr. Fauci. And so here is a graph. Now, I have my thumbnail over it. I've got to move it. But do you see, this is us. And we dropped off a little bit, but this is just in the month of March, and we'll talk more about that. And this is Germany. Angela Merkel, very quickly, put together a body of scientists and said, you will dominate our national response. Merkel is a scientist. Our current president is a scientist, he says, a very good one. But it turns out that look at those other curves. We started, right at the beginning with the others, and we didn't go to a plateau. And here, if you look at the United States, we started going down. Why did we start going down? Because there was subsidiarity. You see what I'm saying? New York, New Jersey, Massachusetts, a number of states said science is going to lead us. And if the federal government is not going to do anything to coordinate with no national plan, we'll do it ourselves. And they did the lockdown, and they started dropping it down, and it turns out that some states started following, but then started opening up again when the president said, look, we need to have the schools open, we need to have rallies, we need, all right, you understand. Look at the European Union. Angela Merkel is a very big part of it because Germany had more cases than any other country in the European Union, but fewer deaths per capita than anybody else in the European Union. Why? Science at the start, and she went for masks, she talked about lockdowns, she had a number of limitations on density, You get the picture. And it turns out that their curve is the curve we would prefer. I think that's enough to start talking. Here I am flying in. This is Valdez. Do you see? This is a ship getting loaded. This is the tank farm. And the pipeline comes in over these mountains. Who do you trust? Ultimately, it was local villagers who knew some of the best information about the currents that the government didn't know. The wind was understood by the local people and the fishermen. It turns out that in the systemic changes that we're talking about now, it's going to be important that we not think of top-down wisdom, that science should be relevant at each level of governance. And for some things, the best information is going to have to be gathered down in the grassroots. Standards may have to be set by the United Nations. But in between is the puzzle, because triangles are rigid and triangles pay off for at least 1% of every society in the market economies I know, but also produce evictions, homelessness, and the disease that strikes those who have the least capacity to resist. All right, so my thought is this picture is not irrelevant to the crisis we face for COVID-19. It's not irrelevant to climate, but we have to shake up the way our society actually mobilizes to address them with a plan before a crisis, but when a crisis comes, a response that's guided not by lobbies, not by campaign finance, but by the reality on the ground and in the generations to come. Okay, is that dismal enough? Because the thing about environmentalism is there are a few wonderful things, but also so many things that government doesn't want to think about, climate being one of them, until the disaster comes upon us. All right, I think I can stop there. David, have I opened up enough? Clayton, have I opened enough? So I think there probably will be a question or two. How are we doing on time?
I think we're doing well time-wise. I think we can go another easy 20 minutes, 20, 25 minutes if people have questions and would like to engage. And David, I know that you probably have some questions. I have some questions of my own, and people should definitely chime in on chat with their questions as well. So, but David, I would, I'd be very interested in where your thoughts are right now and how you want to kick us off.
Yeah. Okay. I was sort of intrigued, by your talk of, the Obama administration's collapse on climate change. What could you talk in a little more detail about what that consisted of and, how he was, you know, how that comports with some of the strong or relatively strong executive actions that he took, including, as you pointed out, the Clean Power Plan and also the agreement he reached with the auto companies on mileage standards, which were pretty ambitious.
Yeah. It turns out that is very publicly tangible. Remember, the Clean Air Act started with the disaster. The grandmothers were falling over dead in Donora, Pennsylvania, and it was covered as, oh my God, what we're breathing. It turns out that fossil fuels were identified by John Holdren, who was Obama's science advisor, as a disaster in the making. And Obama realized that, and every step he took, he thought he was going to have the Congress with him for the second 2 years of his administration. But the fossil fuel industry was spectacular. The Koch brothers, you know, oil people, and the Heritage Foundation and Federalist Society, they worked really hard to win the Senate. And it turns out that that's what killed the Obama administration. It turns out that DACA came early, and DACA was not something that the market hated. Air pollution, that was possible. The Clean Power Plan. Automobiles, it turns out that automobile manufacturers were not at all worried because they had technology that they knew customers would pay for, and they wanted certainty. And Obama gave them certainty. The emission standards recently rolled back. But yeah, this one was the big one. Fossil fuels are, I mean, the lobbyists, there are thousands of them in Washington working for this one industry. And that counts all the lawyers and the PR and what have you. Carter was a babe in the woods. I was working in Washington when Carter was, he was a wonderful guy. He once called me when, in the biggest case I ever had, when he just signed a bill overriding his own policies and my Supreme Court verdict. And he said, I'm sorry, but the political forces were insisting on it. I mean, he was the president of the United States. Obama, however, was a politician. But reading, number one, he was unfortunately a black politician. And it seems to me, David, that's part of the answer to your question. That's glum.
I wonder, go ahead, David.
No, go ahead.
So I'm just wondering, I was talking to somebody earlier today, and they were talking about this time that we're going through and drawing an analogy between the challenges that Americans faced when we were like living through World War II. We have mounting casualties. We've got, you know, some people out there in the world that are not making wise decisions, to put it very like, it's probably being very weight overly kind to the actions that people are taking. But in World War II, there were models where people were able to practice self-sacrifice and support some programs that brought some pretty incredible change. And if you look at, I mean, there was a lot of industries that came together. There's a lot of potential. You mentioned in one slide, Obama was looking at his Clean Power Plan and how that was going to bring a lot of jobs. We have a lot of people that are out of work these days. I think, you know, do you see opportunities? I know it's very easy to get frustrated by how people haven't been able to heed the call, to look at the reports and say, you know, there's this, there's all these things that people should be doing and they haven't done them. Do you see any reason today why things can be different? Why there are, do you see space for hope where, you know, we have such a global problem in COVID that is like the global problem that we had with fascism, 75 years ago, that perhaps there's an opportunity, perhaps we're actually seeing people rallying in any ways. And I know we're not looking at specific examples of rallying, but I can think of, you know, when we think about climate change and I think about like some of Bill McKibben's work and looking at, you know, watching how forests have come back. I don't know if you've been back to Alaska since visiting and seeing these spills. Have we seen, do we have any natural examples of resilience and just systems that have come back and recovered? You know.
Okay.
I don't know.
Tell me, let's, friends, just, you are listening, how many questions did Clayton just ask me? I think it was 13. But you also led us into the answers as well. I mean, there are a bunch of different ways to take it. 1980. The United States started shifting from a communitarian president to an individualism uber alles president. And I could see it in the students. I could see it in the politics of the United States. We became far more individualistic. But we do respond to a crisis where there are casualties immediately. And so COVID-19, there are casualties. And in the war, there were casualties. But, you know, the point was that there would be greater casualties if Hitler was able to take over Europe. There would be greater casualties if we didn't respond to COVID-19. And so the states responded in, all of them had to respond in some way because it was so visible. And the tragedy of climate is that it makes you sweat, but it's not visible unless you go look at the glaciers that used to be there, unless you watch Iceland melting. But so what I'm saying is human nature responds to a crisis that is imminent and visible, tangible. And a climate is suddenly more, starting with Superstorm Sandy, right? And so I think that Obama, if he'd been able to have a bipartisan Congress, could have moved us toward the kind of economy that Europe is moving toward, where coal is increasingly not the basis of the energy systems, and planning is what governs. It turns out that planning in the United States is anathema. It's communism, just like the Russians. Oh no, we love the Russians now. So we are at a fulcrum in history, and there's some really good things going. That is to say, the disaster of COVID-19 is visible, and it is coming right at us. And we know that it's gonna go right up, 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 unless we do something about it. It doesn't miraculously disappear. And climate is at last visible. And I know that if Mr. Biden, I've been a little bit in touch with the campaign, there will be a very active attempt to catch up with the Paris Agreement. But we have to do much more. Carbon fees, it seems to me, is the way to go. The Republicans who are against Trump are for carbon fees. So, you know, but the more you asked your question, Clayton, the more all of us listening to you were recognizing this really is a human problem, that politics reflects the human dynamics, which, I mean, I think most Americans ultimately are communitarian as well as individualistic. And the more they can identify with people dying or houses and forest fires and you name it, the more the politicians who are just there to maintain their jobs will do what they have to do to maintain their jobs. When I was in Washington, there were only 6 members of Congress who always voted on the public merits, and 3 of them were ministers. The rest of the 535 were voting with the triangles in mind, sometimes avoiding the triangles, sometimes being dominated. But do you see why that image to me was such an eye-opening image of how government really works? And then that dipolar system, which really, you know, gets blocked, shifting to pluralism. Well, Obama was the wrong person, I guess, because Mitch McConnell clearly didn't want a black person with 2 terms. But we in the United States, I think, have a lot of bright people and even more caring people than bright people. So the more visible it becomes, I think the better off those systemic changes. But changes, do you see, are necessary economically as well as ecologically. And obviously, science, knowledge has to lead the way. It can't be a game show, a fake game show. that actually produces our national agenda.
We know who the winners of the game show we're going to be in. It's never the contestants. It's always the advertisers. So,
Yep.
We had somebody in one of the chats who wanted to share something that I want to share with you and kind of get your reaction, which was that he feels that the problem with climate change resistance is immediate gratification. It's always been rewarding in the short term to not fight climate change. Al Gore was rightly calling the prospect of fighting climate change, it's an inconvenience. You know, oh, I have to be hot. Oh, it's going to take me longer to get somewhere than I can in this jet or whatever it is. So they're asking, what short-term carrots can we promise to armchair moms and dads who are out there working to fight climate change, so that there's some kind of, you know, are there opportunities for immediate gratification instead of having to wait for the impact for 2 to 3 generations from now? I don't know if you have any thoughts about that.
My thought is that Obama was right, that if you change your energy system so it's focusing on efficiency, which takes a lot of science and a lot of technicians, on alternative sources of power. Again, you know, I grew up in Pennsylvania where the coal mines were using fewer and fewer people, like the Exxon Valdez, like the Alyeska single hull ships. So employment, it seems to me, is a way of saying, let's lobby for what Obama was trying to give us. Let's try to support companies that are moving toward efficiency and alter. I mean, obviously it has to be at a variety of different levels, but the consumer level, the consumer of goods and the consumer of politics, both, you know, are voting with their dollar and That can be powerful indeed. Visibility of crises and you know, commiserating with those you see who are being so hurt because you think, well, there but for the grace of God go I. That gets attention. And you're right, climate is way behind COVID-19 in the immediacy, the visibility, and the shock value. But we're getting there. And George Floyd, I think, will never be forgotten. Eric Garner was forgotten. But so just think of all of the crises, the systemic changes we're facing. I don't think America is digging its head into the sand. And if it does, we're cooked.
Literally.
Yeah.
I saw an interesting study just earlier today. It was, I don't remember the original source. It was cited in PubMed, but it was a study of in hospitals. And stay with me for a moment. It was a study that some hospital systems did with a couple different signs. And the signs were to encourage people to wash their hands. And there was only one word that was different between the signs. One sign said, washing hands will protect, you know, your health. And the other sign said, washing hands will protect patients' health. Which do you think was more effective in getting people to wash their hands?
And to wear masks. Sure.
Obviously, it's all related. So what was encouraging was that there was 45% more soap used next to the signs that said washing hands will protect patients' lives. So similar to mask use, I think if we tell people wear a mask to protect yourself, I have always been taught that we are very self-interested creatures and we will do things for ourselves, but we also think that we're invincible. And we see all these people that are going and thinking, well, I can deal with the heat or with this. But maybe if we tell people, you know, where the one of the suggestions from this was, you know, if we tell people to do something because we care about, you know, we care about our seniors who are, you know, immunocompromised, and we don't want to get them sick. We care about maybe we can't talk about two or three generations because that's too far away, but maybe we can talk about people who have cancer, and we need to be washing our hands so we don't make people with cancer, you know, make their lives any worse. You know, we can paint pictures of, you know, people that we can all know, so we're not thinking invincible us, but, you know, try to trigger this this feeling of empathy for people that we may all know.
Let me give you an example.
Can be an effective motivator.
On the masks, you can hear people saying, live free or die, right? And then you come back and say, well, live free and kill. And what? I mean, yeah. It's if you live free without a mask, you could be killing people you know and love or people you don't know. But that when I said, I think there's a communitarian strain in Americans, many of them don't realize that the mask issue that their president has told them was foolish is actually a protection of people they love and people they don't know, but could kill. Live free and kill should be on the posters anyway.
Shifting from discussion of rights to responsibilities. Yes, it's maybe my right to live, but it's not my right. You know, we have a responsibility to care for each other and not a right to kill each other.
Yeah. Amen.
So another person. I'm sorry, David. Yeah.
If no one else has questions for Sig, I wanted to pose one more.
Okay, we have one other question.
No,
it's quite fine. So there's an observation that capital markets are starting to divest in oil and gas.
That's one of the things I was going to bring up.
I have a story. You know,
there's a movement away from fossil fuels.
I was coming down the steps of the Alaska Capitol late one night. They have meetings late into the night. And this woman said to me, you know, they are putting a gold mine and they're using a virgin wilderness creek as their disposal lagoon. And I said, well, have you talked about it with the guy? Well, of course, yes, but a gold mine? What can we do? I said, are you guys thinking of litigation? She said, well, yeah. I said, why don't you contact the securities analysts in New York and say, this is what they are doing. It is clearly illegal. And the investment you make in this particular company will be blown apart when the lagoon dumping is revealed, of course, as being a violation of the Clean Water Act. And so, do you see what I'm talking about? Capital markets respond to information. And a number of securities analysts said, we would never have known this, but for your citizen letters. A couple of securities analysts said, how dare you defame this important Fortune 500 company. But my point is your point, that we can use information with the market, because the market ultimately, it has to deal with reality. It's learning that now in a way that I think, as you suggest, is going to be part of the systemic change.
There's been a couple of other setbacks for the fossil fuel industry recently. We've seen some pipeline projects canceled, and in some cases because of court decisions, and we're seeing the use of coal in the United States either flat or dropping, despite Donald Trump's efforts to revive the industry. Can we take comfort in those things, or are they just kind of lips, and or might they represent a trend? And if so, why would thing, you know, why, given all the strength of the Iron Triangles and the intentions of the Trump administration, would those things be happening nevertheless?
Well, let me pull Clayton's point into this one. The Atlantic Coast pipeline was ended 2 weeks ago because the financiers for the project said, you know, we don't think it's any longer viable given the volatility of the market and the fact that enough politicians are being pushed by enough citizens as they are in Weymouth now, let's see if there's a better way to invest our any energy dollars. And the Dakota pipeline, by the way, the lead attorney sitting there with the Sioux Lakota chief, Jan Hasselman, is a Boston College law graduate, cool. My research assistant, who has been on TV and is going to be going through hell in the next 2 months. But the point being, Americans are looking at not just people who look just like them. In the ACC pipeline case, the media noticed that there were two African-American communities that were going to be hammered by that particular project. And the companies, the financiers, realized that there was going to be embarrassing as well as potentially losing litigation. And with the Dakota pipeline, you know, Indians have a heartbeat that they share with many Americans who came many, many years after the, by the way, I worked for the Cherokee and they said, call us Indians. Native Americans, that's what they say in New York. But my point being that I think that part of the genius of the generation to come is the ability to transmit accurate information in a storm of inaccurate information. We're still getting that one clear, but just imagine if indeed the bad things that might come or the bad things that are happening can be visible in a way that people will commiserate with, will identify with, that changes things immediately because, you know, people vote where their votes, and with dictators, there are people that have coups. So we're talking about a system in flux, and we're being pushed by disasters, but the way we started, I think, is probably the way we end. That disasters that are well perceived and well described and well understood are probably the best way to advance in every area of societal endeavor. You just wish that so many people wouldn't die. But we are making progress as a planet. It seems to me we're not going backwards.
I'm glad to hear you conclude on that's more upbeat than we've been for a lot of the night. So there's been some other observations of folks looking, and it's easy looking at all the evidence to be confused or just downright frustrated. There's been some comments looking at, you know, looking at the impact of COVID on the oil industry. And we're seeing, you know, gas prices at these crazy lows and glut of offshore oil that is, and just the oil supply seems incredible. So if we can return to that and learn, there was a speech given by Naomi Klein that I caught in a couple different places back. I think I first saw it in March, where she was talking about some of the lessons that she learned researching and writing her book on disaster capitalism, which was just ringing with me as you were speaking, Zig. It's exactly true. Yeah, I mean, there's so many, I mean, and we've seen it used in a lot of different ways. We've certainly seen private industries come in and take advantage of disasters to publicize expenses and privatize wealth and just to do move in that fashion. So I appreciate your efforts tonight to shed some more light on the players and who is who's been benefiting, who's been paying the cost all these years.
One more book, Rebecca Henderson. Rebecca Henderson has written a book on the new capitalism, which is really brilliant. And capitalism obviously has to be part. It's a system that works better than government in certain ways. But the iron triangles, it seems to me, are in the crosshairs. And that's good.
It is good.
Well,
David, any final thoughts? I think we are reaching the end of our program.
I think we've reached the end of our program. I'm delighted to meet you people visually. And thank you, David, and thank you, Clayton, for making this happen.
Thank you very much.
And Martha, thank you for sitting in.
Of course, thank you.
We've had people participating on cross Zoom and Facebook, so I want to say thank you to the folks that have been there as well. It seems like it hasn't been great large crowds in any of these channels, but we have been recording this. We will be making this recording available. So anybody who would like to share those with friends, family members, anyone, as you were saying, it's about information, it's about communication. So we definitely want to do our part to make this information and knowledge available as wide as we can. Thank you so much. It's been a pleasure talking to you.
Thank you very much.
Bye-bye. Thank you.
Good night.
Cheers.